Hello, good evening. Welcome, everyone. Can you see me? I would like to welcome everybody to the webinar on virtual interprofessional education and collaborative online international learning in pharmacy experience in the Philippines. I would like to introduce myself real quick. I'm Muhammad Haniki Nik Muhammad. Currently, I'm the chairperson for the FAPA pharmacy education section. Okay, and with me, I'll be acting as your moderator along with Christine Ching Benosa, Secretary General of FAPA. As shown here, this webinar is hosted by the Federation of Asian Pharmaceutical Association Pharmacy Education Section in collaboration with the Malaysian Pharmacist Society. And we are indeed very excited today because we have lined up five eminent speakers as shown here in the slide, and they will be introduced shortly by Christine. And we also are very excited and honored to have Prof. Dr. Yolanda Robles, the president of FAPA, as the reactor. So I now would like to just give a quick introduction to why we're doing this webinar. Interprofessional learning, as you know, is about having students from various professions like pharmacy, medical, nursing, allied health, etc., to learn with, about, and from each other in patient care. So this interprofessional education exposure during the undergraduate years will provide the students with the needed skills to collaborate later on when they are practicing, whether in the hospital setting or other settings, but usually it's more about clinical settings. Yeah. So similarly, COIL, Collaborative Online International Learning, also provides an opportunity to expose students to beyond the normal professions, and they can go and mingle and learn from, with, and about students or colleagues from other professions. So we had several sessions on COILs exposed to our students when we have this initiative with University of Shenandoah in the US, and also from University in Bosnia. So the students are varied, and they have a project, they work on a project together, and then they come up with learning issues and solutions to real world problems. So it's very exciting, and I know that some of you may only starting to work on IPE and or COIL. So what I think COVID-19 pandemic has pushed us is to have a virtual IPE and COIL. So we look forward to hearing more, and it's exclusive and special, because for the first webinar on this topic, we are featuring the Philippines. So kudos and congratulations to the Philippines for sharing with us this initiative. So before I pass the session to Christine to introduce the first speaker, I would like also to record my appreciation to Jack Shen, who's today representing MPS and FAPA, obviously, but also having to work behind the scene as a technical team, along with other people helping him. So over to you, Christine, and look forward to a wonderful webinar.
Thank you, Prof. Haniki. So before I introduce the first speaker, I would just like to welcome our registrants who will be connecting from 20 different countries for tonight. So we have a total of 1,145 registrants, and majority of the participants for this event are from the Philippines. And the next top five countries are from Cambodia, Malaysia, Mongolia, Sri Lanka, and India. We also have participants connecting from Indonesia, Pakistan, Saudi Arabia, Bangladesh, Nepal, Thailand, Papua New Guinea, United Arab Emirates, Qatar, Turks and Caicos Island, North. So I saw that some participants raised their hand. So welcome all. So our first speaker for today is Dr. Maria Faye Nanette Maximo Carriaga. She has earned various recognitions during her studies and in her professional career. As an academic pharmacist, she was awarded the 2020 PPHA Outstanding Pharmacist in Pharmacy Education and the 2021 University of Makati Most Supportive Dean. She served as a training manager at MedExpress Drugstores for 2 years and went on to become a full-time academic pharmacist for the next 20 years. Having worked at St. Louis University from 1997 until 2008 and at the University of Makati up to the present time. She has been an active member of the Philippine Association of Colleges of Pharmacy, or PACOP, since 1997, and served as an officer of the organization from 2016. She's a member of the Philippine Pharmacists Association, CPD Committee, Bureau of Speakers, and the National and Special Events Committee. Right now, she's the president of FAPA, and her term will be until 2023, and she's also the dean of the College of Allied Health Studies, University of Makati. Please help me welcome Dean Maria Faye Nanette Pereira.
Thank you very much, Ma'am Chai. To the president of FAPA, Professor Dr. Yolanda R. Robles, Dr. Muhammad Haniki bin Nick Muhammad, Chair of FAPA Pharmaceutical Education Section, Ms. Christine Ching Benosa, FAPA Secretary General, to my fellow speakers, dear colleagues, a very blessed and good evening to everyone. Thank you to FAPA in collaboration with the Malaysian Pharmacy Society for this humble opportunity to share along interprofessional education or IPE in the context of a local university in the National Capital Region of the Philippines. Next slide, please. Interprofessional education involves educators and learners from two or more health professions and their foundational disciplines who jointly or together create and foster a collaborative learning environment. The intention is to develop knowledge, skills, and attitudes that result in interprofessional team behaviors, enhancing the teaching learning outcomes and thus competence of students. It has the end goal of inculcating in the students who will become future practitioners the value of team-based approach as a strong enabler of patient-centered care. Next slide, please. IPE is the precursor of interprofessional collaborative practice. It has been said that patient care delivered in silo or in silos, or with compartmentalized thinking or mentality can result to chaos in the form of greater risk of misunderstandings and miscommunications to the detriment of the patient. Therefore, IPE is an important pedagogical approach for preparing health profession students to provide patient care in a collaborative team environment, a good mechanism to improve overall quality of healthcare. Next slide, please. Putting the context on my sharing, University of Makati, the institution I represent, is a public local university existing as a department of the city government of Makati. BS Pharmacy program is 9 years old, the youngest in the college in terms of years of existence, with 130 to 160 students on an average every academic year. The Center of Pharmacy, where the Bachelor of Science in Pharmacy program is offered, exists in the college together with the Center of Nursing, where Bachelor of Science in Nursing is offered. This is the oldest program in terms of years of existence, and followed by the Bachelor of Science in Radiologic Technology at the Center of Imaging Health Science. Next slide, please. In 2013, a year after offering the BS Pharmacy program, reorganization took place, which has driven everyone to advocate one COAS, as reflected in the revisited overall strategic plan of the college. Since then, the seed of IPE started to find its place in the programs and activities anchored on the core values that were set by the college. Next slide, please. Also propelled by the outcomes-based education pilot implementation at the University of Makati in 2012, these activities were agreed by everyone to be done collaboratively. These activities run congruent with the important examples of collaborative activities in allied health education. Next slide, please. For the first one, OBE fairs, they were then exclusively within the nursing program. However, with a changed mindset to behave as one and embrace IPE, GradTech and pharmacy programs were integrated. Teams composed of students from the three programs are made to experience curated clinical scenarios or simulated scenarios in the simulated hospital. Next slide, please. Transitioning from in-person to flexible learning modality was very challenging, but it pushed through just the same through the collaboration and cooperation of administrators, faculty members, clinical instructors, and students. This was in December 2020. Just a clip from that activity, Ma'am Chai, please. Just very quickly.
Laparoscopic right hemicolectomy po.
Thank you, Ma'am Chai. Next slide, please.
So how do you assess level of consciousness?
CS po, we need to be careful of how the patient will take this medication.
So
thank you, ma'am. So this was the second virtual OBE fair last May 2021, culmination of second semester of academic year 2020-2021. Next slide, please. For the second one, grand case presentations, just the same teams are formed, composed of student nurses, student pharmacists, and student radiologic technologists. The cases are actual clinical cases obtained by the students from their clinical rotations. However, these were again curated to ensure fitness for purpose and at the same time to ensure confidentiality of data and anonymity of the patients. Panel of reactors are practitioners who come from the three disciplines. Next slide, please. This was already in the flexible learning mode. So one COAS interprofessional case presentation. Next slide, please. These are for both OBE fairs and grand case presentations. The basic responsibilities of students from the three programs are emphasized. Next slide, please. For the third one, COAS Research Congress, it involves researchers of students, faculty members, practitioners from the industry partners of the three disciplines. During the pandemic, we were further moved to collaborate within the college in order to revisit our research agenda and come up with researches that are highly relevant and feasible given the challenges of the crisis. Harmonizing the essential outcomes of courses that cut across the three disciplines was done, and one of which is the methods of research. We practice sharing of research protocols when applicable, or doing an action research collaboratively and then discussing the results as one for integration and better understanding of the outcomes, also to improve educational processes in the college. Next slide, please. Extension services are also done collaboratively, optimizing the expertise of the disciplines, including complementary and alternative medicine. Offshoots of researches are also shared with the community. There is limited participation of students in this endeavor, most especially now, due to the prevailing situation. However, this is a great opportunity to develop stronger relationships, build trust and confidence and harmony among faculty members, thus encouraging an environment supportive of IPE, eventually creating champions of IPE. Shift to provision of telehealth services to the community is underway. The same is true with these activities organized by One COA Student Council, our student organization that brings and leads all the local student organizations of the three programs together. Again, this is a very important supportive mechanism to foster IPE, student leaders becoming champions of it. Next slide, please. These other activities, though not formally classified as IP activities, are the informal interactions or ways of building up the fertile ground for IPE to grow, finding ways of working together to strengthen culture of three C's: communication, collaboration, cooperation among students, faculty, including preceptors and administrators. This was confirmed in the study by Buring et al. 2009. This hidden curriculum of observed faculty or clinician behavior, informal interactions and conversations with fellow students and with faculty and practicing professionals, and the overall norms and cultures of the training or practice environment is extremely powerful in shaping the values and attitudes of future healthcare professionals. IPE, therefore, is strongly instrumental in having a collaborative, practice-ready healthcare workforce with the end goal of improving individual and public health and even system outcomes, as shown by this figure. The interprofessional learning continuum model. It encompasses four interrelated components as seen: a learning continuum, learning outcomes, health and system outcomes, and the major enabling and interfering factors that influence implementation and overall outcomes. Next slide, please. IP activities in foundational education, though they generally comprise a small fraction of overall educational activities early in the learning continuum, when students are being immersed in the values and information of their chosen profession, and when the formation of professional identity is critical, they serve as a strong base for graduate education and continuing professional development, encompassing both formal and informal IPE learning interventions across the education to practice continuum. One of the important challenges, therefore, is ensuring the alignment of the IPE learning outcomes and specific interprofessional competencies with the professional's developmental stage as supported by the practice environment and the local needs. This model was emphasized in the research done by the college in order to assess the outcomes of IPE. Using records and documents review, mapping, tool development, surveys, and interviews, the college was able to come up with a set of IPE elements and behavioral indicators and tested them through our students, alumni, and the faculty. Next slide, please. Results of the study showed these 9 IPE elements: communication, respect, altruism, excellence, ethics, accountability, enthusiasm, team structure, and leadership. Next slide, please. Extent of application of these common elements was also shown. Overall, respect is found on top of the list. According to one of the students who was interviewed, Respect is best shown by trusting other allied healthcare professionals or students with their knowledge and skills in their respective fields. In addition, it can also be shown by appreciating their desire to serve others and respecting their choice of a particular field to do such. Examples of indicators are demonstrates confidence without arrogance while working with members of other health professions, recognizes that other health professions may have their distinct cultures and values, and shows respect for this, among others. Respect, being on top of the list, was followed by elements, team structure, leadership, and communication. Next slide, please. Overall, the IPE indicators become evident as the students progress in the allied health programs, with alumni and faculty members giving the highest ratings on the IPE indicators. Next slide, please. But looking at these elements or requisites, however, that are critical for implementing IPE, just like in any other system that is organismic in nature, systemic and developing, we acknowledge that IPE in the college is a work in progress, most especially along the last three bullets. Some mechanisms still need to be institutionalized and formalized, and it is not enough that we just actualize or advocate them. But more importantly, as we acknowledge that we are a work in progress, we are also motivated to recognize that the culture of IPE is very much alive in the college. It is developing and is moving forward. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. These are the key messages I want to leave you with. IPE is integral in producing IPC-ready graduates who are purpose-driven, team players, and patient-centered above all else. IPE can be done. It can be contextualized based on the profile of the institution, employing small, bite-sized initiatives, starting small, going slow, and then consistently you grow. IPE is enabled or strengthened by other collaborative activities, those that comprise the hidden or implicit curriculum, which are outside of formal coursework as a matter of constancy of purpose. And lastly, communication, collaboration, cooperation, institutionalization, linkages, and internationalization are ways of building up or moving forward. Which leads me to close my presentation to the next slide. As the president of the Philippine Association of Colleges of Pharmacy and the chair of its Committee for External Linkages, we hope that we could come up with opportunities to work with FAPA to further inspire pharmacy schools in the Philippines, most especially those with young programs in terms of existence, a small, medium-sized based on student population to further motivate us in moving towards this direction, optimizing the flexible, borderless setup that we have right now. Teaching, learning, and research capability initiatives contextualized in this new norm of flexible learning are seen to be very integral and are prospect opportunities for collaboration. So thank you very much, FAPA. I hope that everyone has found usefulness and relevance in this sharing. We look forward to more interactions with you. To God be all the glory. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Maria. That was a very impressive presentation and a good introduction to IPE, especially breaking the silos and building in respect into our students as the foundation for collaborative practice. Thank you so much. I'm sure there will be questions from participants. You can please type it up using the Q&A function and we'll entertain those questions later. But right now, allow me the privilege and honor to introduce the next speaker. We have Professor Dr. Mark Ryan Langit from the Department of Pharmacy, St. Louis University. He has been in the academic practice for 20 years. A department head in 2012 and as consultant in the BS pharmacy program at the University of St. Louis Tuguegarao. I hope I pronounce it correctly. Cagayan in 2014. He was a research assistant at the National University of Singapore and National Cancer Center of Singapore in 2015. He is part of the faculty exchange at the Universitas Katolik Widya Mandala Surabaya, Indonesia, and an invited lecturer at the Universitas Medica Suherman, Indonesia. Currently, he is the executive secretary of the Philippines Pharmacists Association and the chairperson of the PPHA Committee and Professional Specialization. So over to you, Prof. Mark. Please unmute yourself first.
Good evening to all of you. Good evening to all of our colleagues from the different places and points of Asia, to our FAPA colleagues, as we always say in the Philippines, mabuhay. And with this invitation to be able to present to you and deliver to you our experience from our country, from the Philippines, as well as from our beloved university, I would like to share to you, not as this time, not only as the Executive Secretary of the Philippine Pharmacists Association, or that of being the chair of the PPHA's Committee on Professional Specialization, but I humbly share with you our experiences on interprofessional education, as well as on collaboration and even on online learning from the university up north here in the Philippines. I am Mark Ryan Langit, and allow me to present to you in my presentation entitled Virtual Connection from the North. Obviously, we gave the title of Virtual Connection because this is important at this pandemic times, where we still have to be connected, of course, though we have to do it virtually. And I have to include where we are located now, because I would definitely make this as a part of our sharing tonight. So we say it is our virtual connection from the North. Again, good evening. So talking about data of the North, well, I would like to show you more and give you a tour of where we are coming from. I mean, where our university is located. Yes, you know, this is, of course, our Rizal Park, located in the heart of Manila, where our national heroes statue and landmark is, but we're not located in that place. Also showing you, of course, the famed Manila Bay with the metropolis, the Metro Manila skyline. Okay. We are not having that in our city, but of course we like this one. And even we are away from the hustles and bustles of the metropolis. Okay, we have shorter, okay, not so tall buildings, and we will be having more trees, because in fact, there you go, this is where the university is located, with all the clouds, the fogs, and the mountains, and the trees. With this scenery, I would like to claim that we are having this education, this educational institution in a cool city. Hence, my dear friends, we are coming from St. Louis University, from Baguio City, up north of the Philippines. And with that, we have aptly called the university being the light of the North. And just 10 years ago, a decade ago, we had our momentous celebration event of our centennial year. And from being the light of the North, we have also adopted that of the line, the light that transforms. So SLU, or St. Louis University, would like to claim that it is the light that transforms, because as being a light coming from the North, we would like to share this, not to be exclusive only in our place, but coming from the mountains, we would like, of course, to share what we have, to humbly give back also what we have learned. And this we always inculcate in our stakeholders, and that, of course, from our students. And so SLU, being the light of the North, is also being the light that transforms. And that would fit our topic for this evening, for tonight, centering now on interprofessional education, as well as on the collaborations that we have on internationalization, international learning, that with us neighbors, neighboring countries, or even to the connecting to the entire world. Yes, wherever we are, we may be from the north, and I know with our dear colleagues also sharing tonight, scattered all over from the Philippines, no? We may be coming from the north, some from the central, from the south, or south, I mean. Okay, but for us, from St. Louis University, having adopted this mission to transform, we would again say that the light from the north is a light that transforms, which would guide us with being or bringing forth academic excellence, and that of maintaining and retaining our missionary spirit. This is how we would like to inspire our future professionals and to all our colleagues, as we aim, of course, to be a university which is of a missionary and transformative educational institution that is zealous in developing human resources. And that would definitely include our dear professionals, our pharmacists, to be creative, to be competent, socially involved, and imbued with the Christian spirit. And with this, we take pride, as much as we would always say that we, with our humble roots, would like to share with you that we have consistently been a part of the top performing schools list, given, of course, by the Professional Regulations Commission, and acknowledged also by the Commission of Higher Education, that the BS Pharmacy program of St. Louis University has continuously been inspiring the youth, that of our students, that for all our graduates, of course, we have a promise that we are definitely going to help them become like us, be professionals, be registered pharmacists. But with these performances, with everything that we are enjoying, just like all of us academic pharmacists in our classes, in our universities, here comes the effect of the COVID-19. Yes, we, until now, we're feeling it, okay, for going for 2 years already. We have this COVID-19 pandemic effects that we have to send our students home. This is, in fact, what you are seeing, okay, is the main gate of the university. This is one of those poignant times when we have to ask those from the dormitories, okay, and we have to safely guide them going back to their places. As you see, our students, okay, even in the pharmacy program, are coming from the different parts of North and Central Luzon, and now even in the different parts of the country. And with that, yes, we have to heed to that of the call of the healing world, where we have to stay at home in order to stop the spread of the COVID-19. We, the faculty, and most especially our universities, are really feeling this COVID-19 pandemic effects. But with this, this won't stop us. This is not going to just simply make us sulk in our homes, in our places, but we have to see how we can be more useful, be productive, and be able to share still the light to our community. As early as when the vaccination have started, our facilities in the universities have already been used for the vaccination of the general population of the city, as well as of the province. And even the hospital of the university has also been extensively used for COVID-19 cases and operations. This is a part, of course, from what has been adopted already on the flexible learning, understanding the plight of our students. And we would say that nobody will be left behind, especially with the services coming from the university. And with that, it gives us now our realizations from the pandemic. Yes, it is true that there are many uncertainties brought about by the COVID-19 and has required us all organizations, FAPA alike, even that of our different associations, professional associations, companies, and most especially our universities. This has brought us to recognize the leadership and explore new ways. This is important, explore new ways of working for continuity. Having these three realizations, what lessons do we need to learn? How do we take advantage of the experience? And this, what is critical to consider in post-COVID-19? And this I always ask with my students about it. And I am sharing this to you, all of you, of course, because I know that with our event tonight, this is being held in order to uplift everyone, everyone's spirit, that in this part, in this practice area of our profession, we are also having our contributions. Hence, we are contributing as academic frontliners also. And I find this statement very relevant and very inspiring for all, that this time of disruption in this pandemic times, this is also to be taken as a time of opportunity, that by looking ahead through a new and transformative lens, yes, we can reframe our future. That with this COVID-19 pandemic, it is even an opportunity to ensure the world, the public, that we are having a more successful future for science and public health. And of course, this would include pharmacy. And let me share with you, what we have seen coming from Dr. John Cook, who is the medical director of a program at the Houston Methodist Hospital's Deba K. Heart and Vascular Center. He said that one of the biggest lessons we've learned from COVID is that the scientific community, and I think you will agree with me that we can also say that the academic community working together can do pretty amazing things, right? Hence, my dear colleagues here, who are gathered, whether we are sharing or not, and most especially to FAPA, to the education section, the academic section headed by Dr. Aniki, this is one important event because here we are showing that we are working together, not really just to showcase what we do in our respective universities or in respective fields, not just simply to be recognized, but it is more of how we are harmonizing ourselves, our effort to show that we are working together. And yes, we are doing pretty amazing things. And we continue with our professional and bringing forth professional education, interprofessional education at that, and that of how we inculcate among our students the importance of collaborating with each other, and that of how we even expand new horizons, opening our doors, our connections to the world, and beginning here, of course, in Asia as we connect with each other, right? And with this, as I begin to share with you what we have been doing, humbly doing in our university, I would say that as we do with what we do with interprofessional education, this has opened a lot and even begun something that we can really start off with. That of the preparations of our learning materials, our distant learning materials, how we have developed them. Of course, we have our background being academic pharmacists, but in interprofessional terms, it is nice how we learn all of this with our so-called experts. We have our dear friends in the academic community, in the university, of course, we also have our School of Teacher Education. And we are taking this as an example where we have invited our dean of the School of Teacher Education and Liberal Arts in the St. Louis University, where she had spearheaded that of our training with all of us health professionals and academic pharmacists. Together, we have started with this on how we learned how to do this distance learning materials, how we develop them. And of course, we do this and accept it, of course, humbly accept it, working with our experts. So thank you, as we did this also with our colleagues from the education, okay, or the teacher education school. Another is how I would say our collaborations with our colleagues, meaning from that of the pharmacy practice. May I present to you, this is one of our meetings, and I think it's more of, it's also a training workshop that we did with the rest of the faculty of the Department of Pharmacy of St. Louis University, where, can you see that of the arrow there? We have invited, okay, to facilitate this learning session on how to deal with this pandemic situation on online learning. And that is collaborating once again to our colleague who have missed a lot. I would say missed a lot because she has worked with us. She was our former head, but now, like how the light from the north would be shared to the rest, okay, we have the speaker before me, Dean Maria Faye Ninette Maximo Carriaga. Hi, Ma'am Ninette. She was with us and she generously shared to us also what we can do more to be with our students and surviving, again, this pandemic situation. Again, I would say that with this selfless act, this unselfish, okay, efforts, okay, all together, whether you're coming from this school, from this university, or from this area, as much as we maintain those harmonious relationship and that collaboration, we thank everyone because we are really definitely surviving this. And that, I would say, is truly interprofessional efforts. And also, I would like to say kudos, okay, having mentioned, of course, Dean Carriaga, who is now the president of FACOP, but with also the previous administration and officers of the Philippine Association of the Colleges of Pharmacy. I congratulate them coming up with the series of faculty development webinars where they called it as FACOP Acts, how they acted on this situation, on how they made an assessment on coping and transition, and on how they synergized it. They came up one time with this topic on teaching laboratory courses. And part of this webinar series is doing it on the flexible learning mode, where I say kudos to them because they thought of inviting several or from different academic pharmacies from the different universities to discuss how to teach these courses on the flexible learning mode. And then again, this is working with your colleagues, interprofessional, as they have invited these speakers. And we're very happy. We had, of course, one of our faculty members from SLU Department of Pharmacy with Ma'am or Assistant Professor Diane Tiffany Chan, who shared that of flexible learning mode in teaching pharmaceutical analysis. She even gave a title on her talk on meeting at the end point when quantity meets quality. Again, I also stated here that interprofessional education starts among us, the faculty. And that, of course, we can now share it to our students, and most especially also to our other stakeholders and colleagues, our partners. All of these things that we have been doing, this is important as we acknowledge that of the evolving roles of us pharmacists, and we consider that being the evolving roles of our student pharmacists. We have to prepare them well. We're doing all of these programs. We're doing all of these efforts and connections because we know that our future pharmacists need to specialize, whether that would be giving them a chance to specialize in digital, on medical, and even on behavioral aspects. because this is in order to meet where our patients, our clients are, be it virtually, be it at the medical centers or in their homes. And again, in our university, we are thankful that there is a dedicated office helping us with our internationalization and our connection, our linkages. And just like in other universities, similarly, ours is called the SLU External Relations, Media and Communications and Alumni Affairs Office. It's nice they have to put them all together. At least we have a one-stop shop, as they would say, okay? We have been working a lot with them and they are also heading this one, just like what we did before. Here it is. On when we partnered, when we collaborated with the Universitas Atmajaya, Yogyakarta, Indonesia. And I think this was last year. Okay, it was already the pandemic era or situation. And we have successfully came up with that of a webinar series. I think this was held in the months of June, August, I mean twice in August. And it was called the Ethnomedicine and Environmental Health in COVID-19 pandemic. This was done in different platforms, in Zoom, of course, and that of the Facebook, and even in YouTube. So with this partnership of St. Louis University, as well as of the university from our friends from Indonesia, the Universitas Atmajaya, Yogyakarta, Indonesia. So we were able to share also on our end, and also from the university, from our counterpart, from the Indonesian university, where they have talked about that of ethnomedicine also. We had our faculty members from the Department of Pharmacy of SLU who shared on complementary and alternative medicine in the Philippine Cordilleras, because Baguio City, the city where SLU is located, is in the Cordillera administrative region. It is in the Cordilleran Mountains, as we say. So it's a rich source. Also, we find there a lot of our plants. And of course, there would be complementary and alternative medicinal uses up north. And we thank, of course, and congratulate Professor Eva Marie Pasquale for this sharing. There was also a lecture which was delivered by Professor Mary Luz Fiangaan, this time also on VCO products, virgin coconut oil on Tawa Tawa and Lagoon B, where she developed a talk on exploring unconventional weapons, okay, in this COVID-19 pandemics. Of course, these talks were centering on the topic which was developed with this collaboration with these two universities. And showing you, of course, here some of our guests and participants during that collaborative webinar series. And another one, okay, this was just recent also, where we have been invited as a lecturer at the Universitas Medica Suherman, Indonesia, where we talk about research in pharmacy and health amidst the pandemic. I was personally invited by a friend, our colleague, Mr. Ahmed Subagio. This is quite interesting. This is why I have really to include it, because this is where I really see how we do heartfelt, okay, if I may describe it that way, connections. Because Mr. Subagio and I met during one of the FAPA Congresses, if I remember, it was in Bangkok, Thailand Congress in 2016, because we are part of the FAPA 2016 International Staff and Volunteers. Thank you, FAPA, for that one. And so having met there, we had continuous communication with the rest of the volunteers also coming from different countries. And I thank, of course, Mr. Subagio, Professor Subagio, for this opportunity. You see, we build connections. We build this we start with internationalization coming from this fruitful connections that we build with us, among us colleagues. So thank you with that, and looking forward for more. Here, of course, are some of the snapshots that we had. We have, of course, the different students and staff. Okay, I think this was not only with the students of pharmacy program, but I think on the different health professions program also of Universitas Medica Saherman Indonesia. We had from their midwifery program, also in the nursing program and health administration. And we look forward on the next part, it would be their turn also, okay, having a lecture to our students in St. Louis University. This also, we had it, okay, and there would be another continuation on the next days to come, where we are very proud also that we have our alumni coming and continuing with this connections to the world. We have an alumna who presented on good clinical practice, particularly in improving dengue fever vaccination on clinical outcomes. And she is affiliated with SCAG's School of Pharmacy and Pharmaceutical Sciences. We are thankful with this, and with that, we have formed now a connection with the University of Colorado, again from the SCAG School of Pharmacy and Pharmaceutical Sciences. And we're coming up with these presentations and hopefully with more collaboration on how to come up, okay, bringing now our students also, and even most especially that of our products, or continuing with that of their education in these different and good universities in the world. There you go with our alumna. She is Ms. Maureen Padlam Makam, okay, delivering that of her talk on the International Council for Harmonization of the Technical Requirements for Pharmaceuticals, okay, and talking about dengue vaccination. We have invited, of course, our students here. I mean, we have involved our students here, okay, and being involved in that of the study, also as presented by our alumna. This, I repeat, is from the SCAG School of Pharmacy and Pharmaceutical Sciences at the University of Colorado. And then this we have started, okay, and I'm looking forward because I am part of the faculty student exchange program with Widya Mandala Catholic University in Surabaya, Indonesia. And with this, of course, here it is with our series of online consultations and meetings. And we have started. Their students from Widya Mandala have already been enrolled and have been attending classes in SLU, and also our students also be going and listening to that of the lectures to be delivered by our faculty from Widya Mandala. For my part, I would be starting also this November together with the other faculty, even in the different schools in St. Louis University. You see, we are a Catholic university, and with this, we find connections with those from our circle, and we have, of course, the Widya Mandala Surabaya Catholic University. Thank you. And there's much more to share, of course, but with the time that we are given, I think it's enough that I would like to leave with you that let us explore more. And we are very happy to maintain, of course, our international and national affiliations. From on our end in SLU, we have that of the International Federation of Catholic Universities. There is the Association of Southeast and East Asian Catholic Colleges and Universities, the Association of Catholic Universities of the Philippines, even of the Association of the Southeast and Asian Institutions of Higher Learning, the Catholic Educational Association of the Philippines, the Philippine Association of the Colleges of the University, the University Mobility in Asia and the Pacific, and of course, our PAASCO, the Philippine Accrediting Association, schools, colleges, and universities. And more of this, as we maintain our affiliations, of course, this would be able to help us attain our objectives, our responsibilities, and our aims towards internationalization. And with this, with that of the headship of our partners, of course, this one I think is on International Virtual Mobility Online Conference held this early this year. It's called Antenna, or the Internationalization of Higher Education in the Philippines, as it was funded also by the European Commission. Okay, and this is with other academic institutions here in the country. And okay, I skip one there. And also that of Education USA on VERT, we are having such similar with our affiliates. We're having similar activities where we bring to our students how they may choose that of different schools. Okay, there's a virtual graduate school fair, which we just had earlier. I mean, I think this was in August, where there were different participating good, very good institutions from the United States of America. And that, again, as co-founded by the Erasmus program of the European Union of EU, where this is in partnership with Cebu Technological University of St. Louis University, of course, and the University of Cebu, where we had it, it's a very nice term, Friends Project. Okay, how we really stay together as friends, where there's internationalization at home, a national conference in 2021, tackling on equity, on diversity, and inclusivity about internationalization at home. And aside from the affiliations of the universities, it is, of course, nice that we have and we share that of the significant milestones and achievements that we have as professionals, as individuals. This, as when I have started, okay, building also my network with the rest of you, our dear colleagues, and that I would always give it back to our dear colleagues and our soon-to-be colleagues. And I'm very happy to announce and share it, of course, to our students, that of being a recipient of the FAPA Foundation's scholarship on 2021 International GPP training. So I join, of course, the rest of the recipients, not only from the country, but all over Asia. And thank you, FAPA Foundation, with this. And we know that whatever we have here, this, of course, we will give it back, bring it back to the Filipino community, and starting it, of course, giving also to our dear students, our soon-to-be colleagues, our pharmacists.
And thank you, Professor Mark Langit, for that presentation. I'm sorry, we had to cut the presentation now due to time restrictions. So we have to proceed with the next speaker. So our next speaker is Assistant Professor Francis Mo from the University of the Philippines, Manila. She is currently taking her master's degree in economics at the University of the Philippines, Diliman. She is currently involved with telehealth research and dissemination initiatives in and out the university as a member of the telehealth committee. She's also an active stakeholder of the College of Pharmacists Telepharmacy Service. And she serves as a member of the UP Community Health and Development Program, or UPCHDP, which is the primary program that provides interprofessional education and collaboration activities in the university. So she was able to facilitate numerous IPE sessions with the program during the pandemic through purely online and blended learning modules of delivery, together with other faculty facilitators. Screen to Frances so that she can share about her experience.
Okay. So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone from different parts of the world. I am Frances Ngo, an assistant professor and IPE coordinator at the University of the Philippines Manila College of Pharmacy. I will be sharing with you our experience in our virtual interprofessional education sessions in our university during the course of the pandemic. So this presentation has the following objectives. Sorry, I think I'm having trouble. Okay. So to provide an overview of interprofessional education in UP Manila, describe the UP College of Pharmacy virtual IPE experience, and discuss lessons learned in the implementation of virtual IPE. As an introduction to UP Manila IPE, our IPE program is under the UP Community Health and Development Program, which is the unit mandated by the university to enter into partnerships with Philippine municipalities to set up and maintain community-based health programs that will benefit both parties. The UPCHDP's partner province is currently Cavite, a province a few miles south of Metro Manila. We have been with them since 2013. The area that is with the program comprises of 5 municipalities or towns. The UPCHDP is composed of 8 colleges, 6 of which are health sciences and are housed in UP Manila, the College of Allied Medical Professions, Dentistry, Medicine, Nursing, Pharmacy, and Public Health, while Nutrition and Social Work and Community Development are in UP Diliman. CHDP provides the site for the faculty and students' academic immersion and service activities. For the College of Pharmacy, we provide both population-based and community-based interventions through the program. During our virtual IPE implementation, since the students deployed were through our 5th-year public health course, students were given a population-based case. The CHDP implements IPEC due to the program's unique position of having the mechanism of its multidisciplinary nature. So now, right before the pandemic, the CHDP already experienced problems in deploying our faculty and students for IPE sessions and community work due to the Taal volcano eruption in January 2020. Since the municipalities are near Taal, Batangas, so they were part of those who were devastated by the eruption. A tiered evacuation plan has been put in place in the event that the volcano will change its status at that time. Then in March 2020, when the pandemic has hit the Philippines, deployment was strained by quarantine restrictions. It was imperative in the program's plan that even if the students and interns will be allowed by the government authorities to return to the community, that we protect both UP constituents and the population in the community from transmission. When blended learning was implemented and medical interns have been deployed while other colleges have remained in a remote setup, the problem was the slow internet connection and the weak signal. So this was later remedied such that all interns that were deployed in the community only used 1 to 2 devices during the synchronous sessions. Another problem was that community health workers like barangay health workers and midwives, who were major stakeholders of the partnership, were very busy during the pandemic. So since they had additional work and due to contact tracing and other COVID-related activities. So given those problems, we had to reevaluate how interprofessional education would be delivered to our students. There were several iterations to our implementation due to the circumstances of our students and the evolving recommendations of the Philippine government as well. In one of the IPE sessions where pharmacy students were able to participate, we used the following module and objectives. So understanding deeper our community health workforce, by developing develop a clear understanding about the roles and functions of the members of the health workers of the community, analyze interactional, organizational, and systemic determinants of collaborative practice in the community, and to create a plan of action for a given community situation, applying the concept of collaborative practice. So this IPE session was participated by medical interns, pharmacy students, and our community organizers. During the implementation of the IPE sessions, medical interns were already deployed in the community. They had the choice of being deployed in Cavite or go home to their LGU, while the pharmacy students were in a remote setup. The pictures at the right are some of the activities done by the medical interns before our online synchronous session. It was implemented in 2 weeks. In the first week, we had a synchronous session where the faculty discussed the content of the module and the requirements that they need to accomplish before the next synchronous session. Pharmacy students were grouped amongst themselves during this time. The asynchronous session is given for the students to interview a community health worker as a case study to help them understand the health worker's roles and functions as a member of the public health workforce. We pre-assigned our students to make sure that they will not be interviewing pharmacists. They interviewed a DTTB, or a doctor to the barrio, a public health nurse, and a midwife. During the second online synchronous session, the students and interns were grouped together such that no pharmacy student was grouped with his or her previous groupmate and was grouped with medical interns. They were transferred into breakout rooms and discussed the output of their interview with the healthcare worker and were given the following guide questions for analysis. What is the most important public health workforce issue that you have learned from your subject? And what have you realized about the roles and contributions of the various health workers in addressing community issues? I think an advantage of this blended implementation was that medical interns were able to actively share what they did while deployed in the community, while pharmacy students are able to provide patient and population-specific recommendations to the medical interns. Another advantage was since some medical interns went home to their LGU, practices in that part of the country was also shared, while pharmacy students were also able to share perspectives from healthcare workers from different parts of the Philippines. The pharmacy students were able to interview healthcare workers from Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. In this way, we were not only enclosed in our partner community. So these were some of the answers of the students to the guide questions, which was further discussed in the plenary session after the breakout. Their sharing was very insightful and highlights important aspects of IPEC and community work such as communication, complementarity, collaboration, synergy, teamwork, and the community owning their programs. And it also further highlights the problem in the communities and public health, such as budgeting, layoffs of health workers, misinformation, and others. So to the left is how we divided the time for our second synchronous session. Now, as a faculty and preceptor, I learned more than anything my role as a communicator in an online practice-based education. It is important that I am able to facilitate by organizing and providing resources for the students and their interviewee healthcare worker, and to coordinate and synthesize the experiences of the different backgrounds of the students and interns that I facilitate. I had to learn to be a guided assessor to motivate and enable students and interns to provide more experiences, to have a more fruitful discussion. And lastly, to evaluate and analyze their performance. For me, the role of the faculty in IPE sessions is more evident in the virtual setting than the usual face-to-face setting because it is up to us to set the pace and to reduce dead air during their breakout sessions, aside from our useful role of facilitating the case and seamlessly communicating with students, community health workers, and barangay officials. It is also an advantage to be able to share our own experience in IPE as a guide for their own discussions. So these are the different lessons that the students have said they have learned. So it was fun to share our experience and listen to opinions of students in other fields of pharmacy, understand and debunk misconceptions of the different roles of healthcare workers. Cooperation and collaboration is very important, especially in a multi-stakeholder setting. Problems in the community level need to be augmented by strong leadership. Pharmacists are needed in the community as stewards of medicines, and need to share our role as pharmacists in the community to other healthcare students in UP Manila. And also, it was a good learning experience to interview community health workers from different parts of the country. So this was a simple format of an IPE session. So one of our future plans is to divide students in their first to third years and those in the fourth to fifth years, so that the younger students will be using this example of format of role clarification activity as an introduction to IPE. We have identified courses in the lower and upper levels in our college, especially in our new curriculum of BS Pharmacy and BS Pharmaceutical Sciences, where IPE is already being discussed or will be integrated to ensure that as early as in their second year, students already have an IPE experience, while further clinical and community-based interprofessional education will be implemented in their higher subjects and internships. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Francis, for the wonderful sharing. It's enlightening to see how the IPE is embedded into the curriculum and the early exposure to the students as early as second year, along with the clinical part later on. So I'm sure there will be some questions. So as a reminder, again, please post your questions using the Q&A function. We'll entertain the questions later. Right now, we're moving on to the next speaker. It's my pleasure to introduce Mark Harvey Adamson, who's the representative from the Pharmacy Education Section of the Philippine Pharmacists Association. A brief introduction. He's currently an assistant professor at the School of Pharmacy of the Philippine Women's University, where he also serves as the program chairperson. And as mentioned earlier, he's currently a board member of the Pharmacy Education Representative of the Philippine Pharmacists Association. So I would like to invite Mr. Mark Harvey to share his presentation.
Thank you for that introduction. Good evening, everyone. Good evening, our dear colleagues. First of all, I would like to thank the Federation of Asian Pharmaceutical Associations for inviting me to this event entitled Virtual Interprofessional Education, or IPE, and Collaborative Online International Learning, or COIL, in Pharmacy. Currently, the practice of pharmacy in the Philippines is based on Republic Act 10918. We are guided by this law, the Philippine Pharmacy Act of 2016. The main goal of this law is to modernize the practice of pharmacy. And one of its objectives is the development and enhancement of professional competence of pharmacists through continuing professional development, research, and other related activities. Also, the integration of pharmacy profession. Right now in the Philippines, the only accredited professional organization for pharmacists is the PPHA, or the Philippine Pharmacists Association. And we have a lot of affiliate organizations and a lot of different chapters. And currently, the PPHA developed different programs, different continuing professional development programs to help our pharmacists, our dear pharmacists, to develop their skills and knowledge towards the new trends, regarding the new trends in the practice of pharmacy in the Philippines. And if you look at the PPHA vision today, The PPHA is an organization of caring medication experts valued by the health system. We wanted to be valued in the health system. That's why in our organizations are doing programs in collaboration with other healthcare professionals and other healthcare organizations. Because what we wanted is to make sure that pharmacists will be involved in taking care of our patients. We know and we understand, even in other countries, not only in the Philippines, a lot of people, a lot of other healthcare professionals do not recognize or do not understand the importance of our role in the health system. But during this pandemic, they saw, and we can say, and through collaborative discussion, collaborative programs, they now understand the importance of our role in the health system. That's why PPHA adapted the global vision for education and workforce. Because what we wanted is to make sure that pharmacists will be ready to face other healthcare professionals, will be ready to help our patients. We wanted to make sure that they have the right skills, the right knowledge, the right information, so that they can provide better healthcare to our patients. And if you look at the Nanjing Declaration, pharmacists and pharmaceutical scientists accept responsibility for the development and sustainability of an adaptable and capable global workforce, working in partnership for better healthcare through transformative and continuous education. And PPHA adapted this goal and adapted this vision. And we thank the International Pharmaceutical Federation for providing us a framework and a vision that we can adapt so that we are all guided in providing continuing professional development to our pharmacists. So if you look at the global education, training, and development principles and imperatives, the future workforce needs to be flexible in its development, especially during this time of pandemic, wherein we know that there are a lot of uncertainties, a lot of things that are very unstable, and there are a lot of things that is happening, and we need to be flexible. That's why in our organization, we know, and even in other organizations, if you look at other countries, they've tried to adapt in the current situation to continuously provide education to our pharmacists. Because there is a saying that education should not be stopped. Continuous education is really important because especially in our profession, there are a lot of new technologies, new things that is being implemented. So we need to be flexible and we need to adapt. So right now, from live lectures, from face-to-face lectures, we are now doing online webinar, video on demand lectures. And honestly speaking, through this webinar, our collaboration is now increasing. I mean, different activities, different programs, different collaborative programs is now increasing because of this webinar. Because before, we have to travel, we have to go abroad to join you and to join other organizations in developing programs. But right now, through this online webinar, through these different platforms, we can now provide share different programs by other organizations. Best evidence and experience for an excellent education, including workplace education models and workplace learning system, As mentioned by other guest speakers, they've shared also the things that they've been doing in their own universities, in their own programs. And even us, you know, we can also share, you can also share later on through our Q&A, through our discussions, the different initiatives and programs of your own organizations that we can also adapt. And this is a form of collaboration. That's why I'm really happy. This is actually my first time to talk in FAPA and to be part of this kind of webinar, international webinar. And I'm really happy because I am now exposed with other organizations, with other pharmacists. And we know that all of you also practicing different programs, also doing different initiatives that we can also adapt. So I'm really thankful and I'm really honored to be part of this webinar. And we know that we cannot achieve the best workforce without best educators. That's why we have in the Philippine Pharmacists Association, we have training of trainers so that those trainers, those speakers can also provide quality continuing professional development to develop the skills of Filipino pharmacists. All members of the pharmaceutical workforce should have access to the best practice education and also access to systems for continuing professional development. Right now, we've partnered with other platforms, online platforms, to provide video on demand lectures. We are not just doing live lectures, but we are providing video on demand lectures because we understand that pharmacists, they have some of them are working in the hospital, some of you are working in the community, and we have different schedules, and not all of you can attend in one webinar. That's why we provided a video on demand lectures wherein pharmacists can access any time of the day and can listen to the lectures and can develop their knowledge and skills any time of the day. Workforce planning for healthcare for individuals and populations will be based on a team-based collaborative care models. That's why some of our programs and some of our activities is in partnership with other healthcare organizations because we know that we are not alone in this fight or in this healthcare system. We have to work together. We have to work together with other healthcare professionals, with the doctors, with the nurses, medical technologies, etc. Because each one of those healthcare professionals, they have their own role to play and goal in providing patient care. So our commitment, and this is also the commitment of FIP, the vision for pharmaceutical workforce, that all members of our workforce should have equitable access to education and development. That's why, as I've mentioned, we're not just doing live webinars and live lectures, we're also providing video on demand lectures, wherein pharmacists can access those lectures anytime. And all pharmacy professionals will be able to demonstrate continuous development in their skills, knowledge, and competencies. That's why I'm really happy whenever we do webinars, lectures, because thousands of people or thousands of pharmacists are attending and they are committed to really listen because they know that those initiatives, those programs, those learnings are really important, especially during this time of pandemic, wherein we have to work together. We have to collaborate with other healthcare professionals to fight this pandemic and to continuously serve our patients. That's why if you look at the continuing professional education at the time of pandemic, honestly speaking, a lot of us are affected mentally, socially, and even physical aspect of our life are all affected because of this pandemic. But also because of this pandemic, we can now talk to other healthcare professionals. We can now do collaborative programs because communication is now much faster and much easier. because of the current situation, I salute actually all pharmacists. All pharmacists who are serving our patients, even though they're all affected by this pandemic. And because of our capabilities and adaptability in the changes in the environment, we are still doing our best and trying our best to commit ourselves in continuing professional development through education, even though we are also struggling, we are also fighting. And because of this situation, we now have much more patients and much more knowledge and skills, because we can now have more programs that can help our patients. That's why also I just want to share that our organization is celebrating, we've just celebrated the 101 years of PPHA, and the organization launched a program we call Power Up Onward to the Next Century. And through this program, we've created in pharmaceutical education section a different series of webinar relating to or focusing on reframing pharmacy education in the better normal, and also optimizing the virtual borderless learning environment for CPD in pharmacy. Because a lot of because of the current situation right now, there is no longer a border in continuing professional development. Before, if we wanted to be educated, if we wanted to attend webinar, we have to travel, we have to go abroad, we have to go to those event centers for us to be able to listen to the speakers. But right now, at the comfort of our home, at the comfort of our workplace, we can now attend a borderless learning environment. We can now attend continuing professional development webinars. And we can now commit more of our time in continuing professional development. Now, my question for you is, are we ready? Are we future ready? How can we be future ready? We can be ready if we have the right knowledge and the right skills that the patient needs, that our profession needs. And how can we be ready? By committing ourselves, we can be ready, because we will commit to continuing professional development and continuous education. Because what we wanted is for us to have the right competencies, the right skills, the right information, and the right knowledge, so we can provide a better pharmaceutical care to our patients. With that, thank you so much. And thank you so much for listening. Have a great day to all of you.
Thank you very much, Harvey, for showing us how interprofessional education can be applied for those who are already practicing pharmacists. And of course, through the help of PPHA, we know that we can also promote interprofessional learning for different practitioners. So for our next speaker, okay, let me introduce the next speaker. Dr. Erwin Faller is the Director of International Linkages in San Pedro College, Davao. And he's also a professor of the pharmacy department in the university. So he's a visiting professor also in Bournemouth University in UK, and a distinguished fellow of the Royal Institute of Pharmacists in Singapore. Pioneer in the country in bringing MyDispense, a virtual dispensing simulation from Monash University, Australia, in the Philippines. And he also initiated the first in the Philippines, the collaborative online international learning and also interprofessional education using project-based learning, or PBL. He also initiated the first in the Philippines global virtual classroom connecting virtual exchanges in the top universities in Japan, USA, Europe and Mexico. So I'll pass over the screen to Professor Erwin Fuller.
Thank you very much, Ma'am Christine, and welcome all of you to our Internationalization at Home, the SPC COIL IPE Best Practices and Experience. I would like actually to acknowledge to our FAPA President, Professor Yolanda Robles, Professor Henneke, our FAPA Chairperson of Education, our Secretary General, Ma'am Christine Benoza, and also to our Malaysian Pharmaceutical Society Representative, Mr. Jack Shen, and to our participants around the globe. Amindanawan greeting, madayaw na gabi'i sa tanan. Good evening to all. I would like to share our experiences in San Pedro College on the collaborative online international learning or the virtual exchanges as it leads in the international or interprofessional and multidisciplinary engagement of students beyond borders. As we define the collaborative online international learning, or some of it will be saying virtual exchange, is an innovative teaching and learning model that provides the faculty and students the ability to collaborate with peers internationally through the use of an online communication and collaborative tools. The interprofessional and multidisciplinary strategies has already evolved into an online platform since the pandemic. The evolution has moved San Pedro College to innovate its teaching and learning strategies to partnering professors from different institutions who want to enrich their courses with students' interaction and collaborative learning. Professors work together to design and implement the COIL collaboration, allowing COIL to be customized to meet the needs of any class in any discipline. And it takes planning and careful attention to design to have a successful COIL collaboration that benefits the student, the professors, and the institutions. And it actually uses project-based learning or problem-based learning as an approach for learning. COIL promote global learning by exposing the student to the real problems in an international context, allowing the development of their skills, fostering diversity, inclusion, and appreciation of the cultures and their own. As you can see in the previous in this slide, I remember our first virtual exchange was on the pharmaceutical marketing with our partners from the University of Hawaii at Hilo, USA, University of Melbourne, and Kansai University, Japan, in the development of their business plan, which target Sustainable Development Goal number 2, number 12, and number 17. And as what I actually did, we strategically empower our faculty in leading the COIL in every department, as you can see in the slide, with our global partners in planning, finding partners, in kicking off until the culmination of every project that they have made. On the next slide, you can see that then there are actually extended already in the development of a COIL, not only in teaching and learning, but then in the research and development through developing herbal product with our global partner in our SPC Pharmacy Turmeric COIL project headed by the project led Dean Fatima May R. Tesoro. Now, on the next slide, it actually looks into the development then on what is actually, what actually come up in our researches. The COIL experiences was so meaningful for the student, even they actually tried to convince their lecturer to go on with the COIL program, linking the student to a more multicultural, collaborative, and knowledge integrating environment, not only in their classroom or in the virtual classroom, but going beyond into another environment with other international partners. And to our teachers, professors also have a lot of benefits promoting collaboration and linking among professors, generating opportunities for professional development and leveraging the teaching and learning pedagogy with international colleagues. In the next slide, you can see that we have launched our global virtual classroom. This August, which the model is based on the COIL, which combines the four essential dimensions of virtual mobility. This is something innovative that we need actually to adopt in terms of our pharmacy education. First of all, it is a collaborative exercise between teachers and students. Another one would be it makes use of a technology and an online interaction. Number three, it has a potential international dimensions, not only focusing in our culture, but then it can be a multicultural dimensions and integrate into the learning process, meaning it is not actually beyond in terms of your curriculum, but it is integrated in terms of your curriculum. This is one of the examples of a collaboration on mental health with the four global universities on the project focusing on sustainable development goals number 3 and number 17. As you go along with the next slide, there are a lot of examples on the next slide with other COIL activities that develop their cultural competence in the next slide and skills as a global citizen. Beyond in terms of our interprofessional role, that makes elevated into our international curricula to become more globalized. In the next slide, you can see that on November 2021, we will have our COIL on pharmacokinetics and medication review and medication history with University Kebangsaan, Malaysia, wherein we'll be able to share experiences and of course within the curriculum of in Malaysia and of course in the Philippines, sharing multicultural roles then of the pharmacists. And going beyond of that, we expose our student also in beyond academic discourse with our global mobility program for collaborative online international learning with universities from Japan and beyond. And also on the next slide, you can see that even university mobility in Asia Pacific, we also collaborated in with our pharmacy program in with Kansai University, Japan, and Osaka City University, Japan. In the next slide, you can see some programs from Kansai and also Osaka University, Japan. So our pharmacy students have already participated in this program. With this, we are very proud that San Pedro College won the as a national awardee in the first Philippine Higher Education Internationalization Award given by the Commission on Higher Education and University of the Philippines Open University. And we're so excited that even in the CHED Region 11, we are recognized because of our COIL and virtual exchanges and virtual mobility with our international partners integrated into our curricula. On the next slide, you can see also that this is fully disseminated with our international partners, and we have presented in the different fora and symposia and even seminar in developing also with other universities here and abroad. And of course, it is we will be able to present in the upcoming International Virtual Exchange Conference in the USA this coming last week of October. On the next slide, we can see that what are our particular programs or platforms that we actually use so that we'll be able to monitor in terms of our collaborative online internet or our engagement. And this is what we call as our immersive class to class, wherein this is a third space. And this is actually, we document all our COIL engagement in this platform. And this is GRP accredited, and also with our FERPA accredited in the US and also the Europe in terms of privacy and confidentiality of all data of our students. One of the features of the Immersive is a merging of the programs like Padlets, even learning management system in your particular university or colleges. On the next slide, you can see that there are some of our current COIL events this semester. And we are so excited that we have launched almost 20 COIL with more than 20 partners. And you can see on the next slide, these are more than 22 partners collaborating with us with the COIL IPE. On the next slide, we can see that we are also commissioned by the CHED in terms of the research on COIL for the readiness in the country. So this, we're very lucky that Commission on Higher Education given us the task to have a research in the Philippines with regards to the COIL. And of course, on the next slide, the future activities that we have with the COIL might dispense the virtual simulation with our partners from Indonesia and also with Brunei. On the next slide, you can see that what are the, some of the challenges and barriers. It's not always sweets and roses that we can see, but also major challenges, because there are some challenges in terms of time difference. Our counterpart, our partners, are 8 o'clock in the evening, and us would be 8 o'clock in the morning, or sometimes it changes. And that will be one of the opportunities that we have in terms of multicultural, and of course, language barriers is one of the component also of the communication, but can actually be an opportunity later on. And most of all, in the Philippines, according to our research, for our students in a local perspective, that some of them have an N below in terms of Mbps connectivity of internet. Now, in the next slide, what would be our recommendation for the COIL IP if you want really to establish in your institution? Maybe you can see in your, maybe here, no, you can see a potential partners that can actually be integrated in terms of design and training for the COIL IPE. So first of all, you'll be able to have proper design in your curriculum, in teaching and learning strategies, giving them opportunity to be trained and having an IT infrastructures then to monitor with all the COIL programs that you have. And with this, you'll be able to have proper adaptation of a COIL assessment using rubrics to identify the strength and weaknesses of students, particularly on the projects that they'll be able to present. And most of all, very important that we'll be able to be ready to collaborate with one another in our quest in terms of learning beyond learning. So if you want to collaborate, maybe your neighbor here, or maybe you know, within this forum, we'll be able to collaborate. Just contact us. We are just one call away, or just PM away. Contact us and email us if you want to collaborate. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you very much, Prof. Erwin. Very interesting, very inspiring, and congratulations for having such accolades in terms of pioneering COIL in the Philippines. And I'm sure more will come in the future, whereby more universities or institutions globally will participate. So I look forward to also participate in future events. So thank you to all the speakers. They have been very wonderful, as I'm sure all of you would have agreed with me. We still open for question and answers. We've obtained a few. So actually, we have tried to
take question and answer.
Yeah, take the question yes. and answers. So there have been questions collected prior to this webinar through your registrations. I think some of them have already been addressed by the speakers in their respective presentations. And there's one question that I've responded just now. And then there also, I would like to open now to other speakers if they want to add to the questions asked earlier. And then you can wrap up and give your final summary in 1 minute or so. So if I may go back to the first speaker, Dr. Maria.
Yes, Dr. Haneke.
Yeah, so you have 1 minute to respond to any questions that you wish and also wrap up. Go ahead.
I think that question pertaining to how they can start IPE in their institutions. So I think the most important thing is for them to be able to contextualize. So they have to work within their means. They have to understand the situation or the environment that they are in. So they have to work within their means. They have to be very consistent on how they do things in the college or in the environment that they are in. And they should not forget that they really need to collaborate. So that's it, I think. The most important thing is you have to contextualize and work within your means. Yeah.
Exactly. Thank you. Yeah. This also relates to one of the questions that we received regarding improving access to the CPDs and improving the education. Yeah, we have to contextualize and work within our means. When we have problems, students accessing the internet, for example, we have to look into ways whereby we need to help them either financially or other means so that they would be connected. So I now invite Professor Mark Ryan with us. He had connectivity issues talking about
issues.
So I move on to Assistant Professor Dr. Francis.
Good evening. So regarding this question in the Q&A box, what we do in our university, in terms of our sessions, we don't require our students to join us in our synchronous sessions, and we provide ample time for the students to submit their activities, and we let them choose if they would want to have their activities individually or by group, as long as the whole class is actually amenable to the decision, then we do it for the students. We also provide longer time for the students to accomplish their submissions and their activities. And if they also request for longer time, we also do that for them. Some universities provided laptops and iPads. Some universities also provided prepaid SIM cards for the students to be able to join in those synchronous sessions.
Okay, great. That's what we do over here also. So last but not least, Prof. Erwin.
Yes, I think with this pandemic that we have in terms of the online learning, it becomes our weapon, our opportunities into becoming seamless, borderless, and of course, there's no turning back already. We cannot actually go back with our time. This is actually, there's no turning back. COIL can be adapted in all disciplines, in all topics that leverage our curriculum to become more internationalized and building global partnerships and prepare globally competent students, equipping them for more for work and civic engagement in a very global context to become a global citizen. So I think with that, there are a lot of strategies that we can adopt. If ever you need help in terms of putting up a COIL in your university and or colleges, we are here to actually help you with FAPA and also with our kababayan, with our co-Filipinos here. This is actually the advent for all of us, not to compete, but then it is an advent in terms of the keyword would be collaboration. That's for
right. Exactly. I look forward to having another smoking cessation COIL with you and other colleagues, because we had trained and certified pharmacists from San Pedro and I think the region, isn't it? Okay, so we look forward to for IPE on that topic soon. And I think with that, I'd like to close the Q&A. You can still write down your questions in the Q&A chat box, and I would like to now, it is my great honor to invite Professor Dr. Yolanda Robles, the president of FAPA, as the reactor for today's webinar. She needs no introduction, but I will go ahead and introduce her so that I will do justice. So she has been with the academy for 35 years and has assumed a position of leadership in pharmacy education as Dean of the UP College of Pharmacy from 2001 to 2007, President of the Philippine Association of Colleges of Pharmacy from 2004 to 2006, Chair of the Commission of Higher Education, Technical Committee for Pharmacy Education, and as President of the Asian Association of Schools of Pharmacy from 2012 to 2013. Her assumption of the FAPA presidency from 2021 is expected to move forward the quality pharmacy education and practice agenda in Asia. So great pleasure and honor to invite Prof. Dr. Yolanda as the reactor for today's webinar, please. Please unmute first, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Hanki, for the kind introduction. So I will be sharing my slides since I was, my ears are really focused on listening to our five speakers, and therefore I was able to come up with some generalizations regarding the topic of this webinar, which is the virtual interprofessional education and collaborative online international learning in pharmacy experience in the Philippines. Well, I put in one slide my two generalizations. The Philippines showed strength in the promotion and application of interprofessional education through the experiences of all our speakers. They showed a variety of approaches and activities both at the undergraduate level and at the professional level. And this is really to promote collaboration, teamwork, and cooperation among pharmacists and other health professionals for the common purpose of improving the quality of healthcare in the country. The collaborative online international learning in the country is quite evident in the experience of San Pedro College and is developing is in its developing stage in other academic institutions represented in this webinar. So I know that moving forward, there will be more engagement between the Philippines and the other institutions from other countries. And of course, this will be a time where we could see harmonization of education in Asia, which is characterized by diversity because of the multiple cultures that we have. I was very diligent in really writing down all the important points, but I will not discuss this anymore in view of the limitation of time, but I will show you that I have from every speaker be able to synthesize their experience and looking at the strengths, and I could see University of Makati as a model of a public university with a college of allied health sciences utilizing virtual IPE approach as to promote collaboration and teamwork among the different disciplines. So I could say that our speaker said that it's a work in progress. Now, with regards to the experience of our colleague from the University of St. Louis, which is the Dr. Mark Ryan Langit, it is here. He had given us examples of how they have implemented IPE, and this is not only among the health professional programs, but even with the College of Education. And he also shared with us the exchange programs that they're having with other universities outside of the country. And very important is their engagement with Catholic organizations, academic organizations, which makes it easier to be able to establish collaboration. And then we have the experience in the of Assistant Professor Ngo from the University of the Philippines. And so this is a model of virtual IPE, which only happened during the pandemic. So they have to shift to population-based cases and utilize blended learning methods, which were modified due to the identified problems. And you could see that one thing that I could see here is the flexibility in how they deal with the students given the nature of the limitations in the country. So some of the good feedback that they generated from the students are communication, complementarity, teamwork, cooperation, and community ownership of the program, and even faculties were able to learn from the experience. And from Assistant Professor Mark Harvey Adamson from PWU and PPHA, actually, he highlighted the role of professional organizations like the Philippine Pharmacists Association in helping pharmacists to be competent in assuming the various roles of the pharmacist in accordance with the new pharmacy law. So what is clear in my mind with what he said was that PPHA adopts a global framework approach in its continuing professional education program and had developed flexibility to accommodate changes, the new technology, and the disruptions. So they have online webinars, video on demand, in collaboration with various partners and healthcare organizations involving other health professionals. And from Dr. Erwin Fallier of San Pedro College, you could see that he highlighted the role of COIL when it was started during the pandemic. It says that it was customized to the needs of the students in various disciplines using problem or project-based learning. And very evident was the international exchanges with various universities abroad. So they have launched the global virtual classroom. They he had mentioned about COIL on pharmacokinetics and also the program on immersed class-to-class project, as well as virtual simulations using My Dispense. I could say that there is an extensive partnership with various universities in both Asia and beyond. No? And therefore, he also mentioned that COIL has its challenges and opportunities, but ended up with a invitation for all of us to be involved in this area where we have to strengthen our linkage with other institutions in Asia. So therefore, in the Q&A, because I was also asked to mention about it, and the question is on how to start IPE in their institution. Din Cariaga was able to mention about the importance of contextualization, working within the means, and be consistent, and the need to collaborate. No? And the Assistant Professor Ngo really emphasized flexibility in engaging students in both synchronous and asynchronous sessions in IPE. And for COIL, as Dr. Fallier mentioned, collaboration is the key. And he had offered help from their institution for those who would like to start this. Now, since I am representing FAPA here, and because it was mentioned when I was introduced that my role really is to how to move forward the pharmacy education and practice in Asia. And I would say that given that our webinar is on IPE and COIL, therefore FAPA as a regional organization should also move in the spirit of international collaboration if we would like to move pharmacy education forward. And therefore, our organization should proactively engage member countries in education-related activities through the FAPA Pharmacy Education section. And I think this webinar is an evidence that we are moving in the right direction. This is a series. So this is first of a series, and therefore, next time you will be learning from the experiences of the other countries. And this is good because we will also be providing this platform for sharing academic experiences and opportunities and challenges affecting pharmacy education in Asia through webinars, short trainings, and FAPA congresses. So I hope that you will stand by and wait for our announcement for the FAPA congresses, which is also a venue for students and faculty members to share their research. And if it will be virtual, then it could be a virtual congress where all of you could participate. And FAPA should also promote and publish research on pharmacy education in the region. So it's not only the sharing of experiences, the teaching and learning approaches that we have talked about tonight, but we should also look at research as a means by which we could link with each other and really improve the quality of our education in our countries. And of course, we have to work with national academic organizations. And there was also the desire of Dean Cariaga and also being the president of PACOP, or Philippine Association of Colleges of Pharmacy, to be linked and to continuously work with FAPA, and therefore that is something that is in our mind. No, we work with national academic organizations and other regional organizations such as the Asian Association of Schools of Pharmacy, and that is to achieve advancement of pharmacy education, which I described that it should be responsive and relevant nationally, and at the same time something that we could share with our colleagues in the Asian region. So with that, thank you very much, and I encourage you to be involved in FAPA activities, and it will not just be the FAPA pharmacy education section. We have other sections which are we have the industrial pharmacy section, hospital pharmacy section, community pharmacy section, and all of this will have their own activities from now to the coming year. So please stand by, and I hope that you will participate in our future activities. So thank you very much, Dr. Haniki, for initiating this particular webinar for the pharmacy education section. And I also would like to thank our secretariat headed by Christine Benosa, and also all of our speakers who have really given their best to share their experiences to our colleagues in Asia. So thank you very much, and good evening.
Thank you so much, Prof. Dr. Yolanda Robles, for the wonderful summary as a reactor to the webinar. Indeed, there are many steps that we need to put into place moving forward. And we know that more webinars coming, and probably a workshop, hands-on workshop training for people interested to actually learn more and do IPE and COIL. So we now invite everybody to switch on their cameras if you wish to have your picture taken. So while we're doing that, allow me on behalf of the organizing committee to thank all our wonderful speakers for their time, for their effort, their sharing, their invaluable insight, and also offer of help. And of course, thank to Prof. Yolanda Robles for gracing us as a reactor just now, and also for the support, and of course the whole team. The secretary at FAPA, also MPS, head by Jack. Is Jack shown here? Is your camera on? I can see him, but I'm not sure. Everybody, okay, you can see. Yes. Okay. So, okay, all the participants, if you want to take a picture, you're most welcome to do so. And Christine will do the countdown, or Katrina to take a picture, maybe a few shots. So,
take a picture. 3, 2, 1, smile. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. So thank you also, Professor Haniki. So just a reminder to everyone, this is actually just a part one of a two-part series on this topic. So in the next webinar, also on virtual IPE and COIL, we will be having speakers from more Asian countries to share their experiences. And we will also be sending out a survey on the prevalence of IPE and COIL, and also come out with a publication. So thank you very much. We appreciate you guys spending your Friday night with us. We feel very honored and happy.
Thank you, Jack. No, I forgot to mention Jack, the president-elect of FAPA, who is at the background.
Technical. So,
Thank you, Kat.
Thank you, everyone. Good night. Have a good weekend.
Thank you, everyone.
See you again.
Enjoy the weekend. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.